Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is Sunday, June 3rd, 2018. This is the second Sunday after Pentecost. Our pastor is the Reverend John H. Pollock. Our organist is Greg Nolte. Today is Communion Sunday. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Thank you. Please turn to page 147 in the front of your worship. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Today.
Good morning. The first reading is from Deuteronomy 5th chapter. Observe the Sabbath day and keep it holy, as the Lord your God commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, or your male or female slave, or your ox or your donkey, or any of your livestock, or the resident alien in your towns, so that your male and female slave can rest as well as you. Remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God brought you out from there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God commanded you to keep the Sabbath day, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Sing with joy to God our strength, and raise a loud shout to the God of Jacob.
Raise a song and sound the timbrel, the merry harp and the lyre.
glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in clay jars, so that it may be made clear that this extraordinary power belongs to God and does not come from us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not driven to despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be made visible in our bodies. For a while, we lived. We are always being given up to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus may be made visible in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia.
Thank you.
Is it a day of restrictions? It is a day in which, because of laws that have been made by man, that we cannot show compassion to someone with a physical need. Is it a day when we should dress up, sit down, and be quiet? Is it a day in which we worship God and then do nothing else for the rest of the day? Or is it a day in which we worship God and then go about the day doing those things that we don't normally do during the week or have time to do during the week? The great reformer Martin Luther, speaking on the purpose of Sunday, said this, quote, "Take heed that you do not despise the preaching and neglect the word of God. Second, see to it that you speak of it seriously, hear it, sing it, read it, use it, and learn it." End quote. So what Martin Luther is telling us is that the purpose of Sunday, which has become the Sabbath or the church, has nothing at all to do with restrictions like we see in our gospel lesson this morning, where the Pharisees are upset with our Lord Jesus Christ because his disciples are going to a grain field and they're picking heads of grain in order to eat them because they're hungry. Well, according to Pharisaic law, picking grain was harvesting. Harvesting was work. Work was forbidden on the Sabbath. We also see the Pharisees upset with Jesus for healing the man with the withered hand. So we can pair that attitude for the Sabbath with that of Luther's, which says it is for the purpose of hearing God's word, singing God's word, hearing God's word, learning God's word. It's a purpose to praise God for the gift of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is meant for worship, which stresses the love of God. There's some of the preachers that I heard growing up would remember that on Sunday morning. All that I would hear from them was hellfire and damnation. And the purpose is to stress the love of God. And for us then, having that love of God for us stressed, that we then in turn love to worship him and hear his word. Those of you who remember the definition or the explanation of it in the small catechism to the third commandment, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. And remember it says, we should so fear, love, and trust God that we do not despise his word or the preaching of it, but gladly hear and learn it. That is the purpose of Sunday. Luther is teaching us that Sunday is not a day of doing nothing, forbidding everything, and making everyone miserable. Sunday is a day to praise God and to learn his word. But hearing his word is not enough. We need to study. To study what the word means in our daily lives and how it can guide our daily lives and whatever we are confronted with that day. And it's not just the church that we need to hear God's word or study God's word. But all families need to study God's word. Families cannot leave it up to Sunday school classes, catechetical instruction, and youth groups to carry the load. Each family must study God's word. For a Christian, Sunday is not a restraint, but a gift. A gift, as we see Jesus making this point in the second chapter of the Gospel of Mark, the 27th verse, which we read a few minutes ago, when he said that the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. But unfortunately, the Pharisees, and then in the history of the church, especially the Puritans, seem to have forgotten those words of Jesus and turned it around to make it seem like we were made for the Sabbath, instead of the Sabbath being a gift for us. Today, in the society in which we live, Sunday is mostly ignored. In fact, I just wonder if Sunday disappeared altogether as the Lord's Day, would anyone even miss it? If you murder, if you steal, if you commit adultery, or if you lie, then society is dead. If you do those things, many people suffer. Not just the person with whom you commit the crime against, but all their relatives and friends who are affected by that. But if you sleep in on Sunday morning or decide to work on Sunday morning, then there probably won't be any repercussions in society. At least, not until now. We haven't heard of any society crumbling because of people ignoring the Sabbath. But as we look at our society today and see all the division and all the vitriol and all the anger and all the separation, we have to wonder if ignoring this Sunday is causing us to crumble in the same way Western Europe. Back in the days that we grew up, when Sunday was a special day, and when radio and TV stations had to provide airtime up until noon for local churches to have their services broadcast, we seemed to have lived in a much more lovable and a society in which there was more harmony and more goodwill towards one another. But since we have changed Sunday into being like any other day, for the most part, we see what is going on today. But there seems to be an animosity towards Sunday, and especially animosity toward any attempt to bring Sunday back to the way it was in the 50s and 60s when I was growing up. Maybe this animosity is due to a rebellion against the way Sunday used to be enforced when many people were growing up, or in many communities it has very strict observances for Sunday. Sunday, at one time, was a day of enforced silence, policed rest, restraint against recreation of any kind, a day to dress up, sit down, and be quiet until the day was over. And still remember my former Old Testament professor, the late Dr. Frank Solomon, describing to us what it was like for him as a boy growing up, I guess it would have been in the late 30s, early 40s, in a small town in Pennsylvania. He said that when he grew up on Sunday, he dressed up, he went to Sunday school and church. They would then go to their grandma's style hammers for dinner, or what you call lunch. And afterwards, you would just sit in and listen to the radio. Not to a ball game. Not to the popular music of the day. But opera. That was the only thing on the radio all day long until the Sunday was over. Fortunately, for me, it wasn't that bad. As he told us, stores were locked up, movies were closed, ball games were forbidden, and public amusements banned. All because of what were known as blue laws. Blue laws were created to keep Sunday from being violent, to prevent Sunday from being just another day, so that people would recognize it as the Lord's Day, as the Christian Sabbath. Blue laws supposedly received their name from the color of the Puritan's nose as he or she sat rigid and frigid in their house, looking out the window to keep their eye on their neighbors to make sure they weren't violating any Sunday laws. The day was never meant You didn't do it. Now, by the time I was growing up, at least in Louisville, they had dropped the restriction against restaurants and movie theaters and ball games and going to the park or to an amusement park. You could do those things. But all the stores downtown were closed. All the grocery stores were closed. The only thing allowed to be open were gas stations, convenience stores, and pharmacies or drug stores. But they, when you walk in, so we would have these big black shades pulled over row after row with big black leather not sold on Sunday. So you'd have very few shelves that had anything available in the house. Well, the first incident I remember is it was a Sunday. We'd gone to Sunday school church. This time we were living on my grandma's farm, and we had had dinner. And my little sister and I decided, for some reason, that we were going to go out in the front yard and rake leaves. So we were in the front yard of the farmhouse, raking leaves and having a good time, and suddenly our older sister came out and she told us, "Have you forgotten this is Sunday? You better run to the drive as fast as you can, put up the rakes, and hopefully God won't see that you're violating the Sabbath." Of course, with that, my little sister and I ran as fast as we could to the garage, hung up our rigs, and then hid for a half an hour, believing that God wouldn't be able to see us, strike us down the plane. The other event, which really involves one of the little ones instead of the attitude towards them, was my sophomore year in high school, and one of my buddies got his driver's license before the rest of us, and so we were driving around on Sunday and we went into convenience store, and of course I knew about the blue balls that they were around, but we thought we knew what we wanted to go in and buy, we could buy them something. We went to our sugar and we discovered we couldn't buy it. And so we were talking with the clerk and he was telling us, reminding us about the blue balls and what you could sell and couldn't sell. He had brought up the point and he said, "These blue balls are really strange." He said, "I can't sell baby diapers. I can't sell baby formula or baby food," somebody mentioned. "But I can sell beer and gasoline." I guess it wasn't a necessity to feed your baby, but it was a necessity for people to be able to go out on their boats with their beer on the Ohio River or one of the other lakes throughout Kentucky to enjoy themselves all afternoon. You couldn't buy a lot of that. You buy aspirin, but hardly any other kind of medicine. That's how strange the blue laws were, but they were to protect the Sunday. Historically, of course, the Sabbath is Sabbath, not Sunday of the third commandment. Saturday, the last day of the week, the day God rested from creation. And so when the church was formed, the early Christians would gather to worship both on the Sabbath and then gather again on Sunday morning. The majority of the early church members being Jewish, they still felt an obligation to observe the Sabbath, which began at sundown Friday and ended at sundown on Saturday. Then they would come back on Sunday morning in order to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, his victory over the tomb, his victory over sin, death, and the power of the devil. So that's the way the church operated for many years. Saturday was replaced as a day of worship in the 4th century AD when Constantine the Great, the Emperor of Rome at that time, became a Christian, made Christianity the faith of the empire, and declared Sunday to be a holiday for Christians. And so with that happening, attempts were made to treat Sunday with reverence, to treat Sunday special, because that was the day of the Lord's resurrection. And so, trying to protect Sunday, as humans often do, we overreacted, just like the Pharisees and the Puritans. And the people experienced undeserved punishment for so-called violations of Sunday restrictions. In the 17th and 18th century here in America, the American Puritans who dominated New England stocks, by fines, and even in prison. A few examples. Two lovers were accused of violating the Sabbath because they sat together holding hands under an apple tree. Convicted of violating the Sabbath, they were sentenced to 3 months in the dunking school in the river. A soldier, for wearing a piece of old hat, putting it in a shoe, stick to his shoe so he could protect his foot, was fined 40 shillings for doing this heavy work. Captain Kimball of Boston, captain of a ship, in 1656 was put in the public stocks for 2 hours for his, quote, lewd and unseemly behavior, end of quote, which consisted of kissing his wife in public on Sunday on the doorstep of their house after his return from a 3 month voyage. And then, if you're not familiar with the stocks, those are those things you see the wood usually they were on a vertical post. Stuck their hands and their head through them, and the piece of wood came over, and you were stuck like that for however many hours. And sometimes people would throw up vegetables and stuff at you to increase your point. And then, the most absurd, a man who had fallen into the water absented himself from church to dry his only suit of clothes. He was found guilty of missing church and publicly whipped. That is the way Sunday used to be enforced. All the while, those with such attitudes were forgetting the words of Jesus when he reminds us that the Sabbath was made for us, not us for the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made to give us a day of rest from our normal activities and to give us an opportunity. But the Pharisees, like the Puritans after them, thought that you had to protect that day of worship and have all these rules and regulations surrounding it to protect. And so the disciples were guilty of harvesting, not on the Sabbath. And then Jesus was guilty of violating the Sabbath by healing the man's widow. And as Jesus asked the Pharisees, quote, in verse 28 of that second chapter, or the third chapter, verses 1 to 6, is the synagogue with the man with the hand. He says, quote, is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do harm, to save life or to kill? Of course, the Pharisees wouldn't answer. Because if they agreed with Jesus, then they would look foolish for having been opposing him all the time, and if they opposed Jesus, then they would look like they were heartless, cold-hearted, having no compassion, as here this man was with this widow. But in their attitude, Jesus could wait till tomorrow, the Sabbath was over, wait till Sunday to heal him. But Jesus, by his healing, it shows us that physical need takes precedence over ceremony. Passion for others was more important than carrying out rituals made by them. This is something the Pharisees forgot. This is something the Puritans forgot. Sunday is a day to replenish our faith after a week of trials. It is a day to remind us who created us and a time to step back and reflect to see God's hand in our lives. A time to set our life back in order. In the early 50s, when radio was still king, there was a mountain man in Montana. And he listened to NBC radio religiously. And his favorite pastime was to play violin. Well, his violin got out of tune, and he had no way to retune where he lived. So he wrote a letter to NBC Radio asking them if on the following Sunday at 7 p.m., could they strike an A so that he could retune his violin? Well, you can imagine when the letter arrived at NBC headquarters in New York City, that they first thought the letter was a joke. They thought somebody was pulling a prank on them. So they began passing the letter around, everybody in the studio, everybody at the station. And the more they passed it around, the more suddenly people started thinking, this probably is true. This probably really is somebody serious. Seriously needing an A. And so sure enough, that following Sunday, exactly 7 p.m. on that Sunday night, they interrupted their regularly scheduled program to strike that A so that he could retune his mind. It sounded an A to give that listener his pitch. God does the same for us by giving us a sermon. It gives us the pitch to retune our lives for the coming week with our faith renewed. We should realize that Sunday gives us that chance to retune our lives and to realize that it is not a day of prohibition, but a day of joy, a day of thanks, and a day of pleasure. It is a day for us to remember the other thing Jesus said about the Sabbath in the 28th verse of that second chapter of Mark, when he said, quote, so the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath. Jesus is the Lord of the Sabbath. Not human beings. Not religious leaders who think it must be protected and give us all kinds of silly rules and regulations. Jesus is the supreme authority over Sunday. He is the controller. He has the supremacy over anything we can come up with. And by his actions in our gospel lesson today, he shows us that Sunday is, yes, a day to worship God, but also a day to show compassion, to put the needs of others above rules and rituals. So when you understand what the true purpose of Sunday is all about, then you can loudly proclaim along with the writer of the 118th Psalm, who writes in verse 24, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in good Christ. Please turn to page 104 in the front of your worship book.
We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The Lord provides for his people a place of rest in his Son, Jesus Christ. Let us commend ourselves, one another, and our whole life into his loving hands. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Holy Father, remember your church throughout all the world and give to your baptized children a rich share in your light and in your peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
At the dawn of time, you commanded the light to shine in the darkness, and through the preaching of your Son's victory, you have made your light to shine in our hearts. Bless the proclamation of all the servants of your word, that they would never proclaim themselves, but instead proclaim Jesus as Lord, and themselves as servants for his sake. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Kind one, in the gift of Sabbath to your ancient people, you taught them that all had a share in the goodness of your creation. Remember all who struggle to find employment, to get out of debt, to provide for their loved ones. Open the hearts of all, that we may share with one another in your rich bounty and be delivered from all greed and selfish care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hope of the heavy hearted, remember in your love all those who are afflicted in any way, that they may not be crushed, but perplexed, that they may not despair, but persecuted, that they may not be forsaken, and those struck down, that they may not be destroyed. We especially commend to you all whom we have been asked to remember at this altar. Annis, Brandon, Julie, Sally, Janet, Sally, Loretta, Christina, Debbie, Mary, Riley, Hannah, Emma Lou, Mike, Tommy, and Jerry. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father of glory, your Son revealed himself as Lord of love. He set before us his own rich feast in which he still touches us and heals us and does us good, inviting us to receive the very ransom price of our salvation, his true body and blood. Help all who come to the altar today to rest in his promises and to revel in his love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Source of all being and life, receive our grateful praise for all those who died trusting in the Savior's mercy and so live in him forevermore. As we await the day of the resurrection, when the Spirit will cause the life of Jesus to be fully manifested in our mortal bodies, fill us with hope and joyful expectation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we come and offer him, we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Gina Pollock and Sharon Leach are ushers today, and they were collecting the offering.
Come, Holy Spirit.
with your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars. We praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered in one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus called us.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come to the banquet, for all is now done.
Thank you.
Mighty Lord Jesus Christ, in his precious blood, strengthen and preserve you in true faith and the life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. God of abundance, with the spread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world, and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration with How Firm a Foundation, hymn number 796, in the back of your worship, hymn number 796.
Our Sunday service, June 3rd, 2018, the second Sunday after Pentecost. St. John's has a food pantry open Wednesdays 9 to 10:45. They have an outreach store open 9:30 to 1, Monday through Friday, closed Thursdays. Rainbow table is every Friday from noon to 1. Everyone is welcome. Again, St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.